the event to please commence.
Good evening. Before I begin, I want to thank our host, a sponsor who made this event possible. So this event has been sponsored by the royal family of Abu Dhabi, the Sheikh Tamim Al Nahyan family. Their CEO was supposed to be here, but he couldn't make it, so he's asked me to read out a small thing which I'll compress it much further. This is about the Abu Dhabi and India relationships, which has been on the rise in the last few years. Since the new government has come in five and a half years back, there has been a conscious effort to strengthen the relationship between the two countries. India is already the largest trade partner of UAE. For us, UAE is the third largest trade partner. The trade between the two countries is closed in the range of some $50 odd billion. And this is likely to rise further with the kind of commitments, both the leadership that they have made. The importance of India for UAE can be sensed from the award which has been recently conferred upon Mr. Narendra Modi, the honor of Syed, which is the highest civilian award for Abu Dhabi, anybody. And we are very happy that our Prime Minister has received that. This program is sponsored by the private office of the royal family of Abu Dhabi. And their message is that they invite all Indian companies who have a vision to expand out of India to look at Abu Dhabi as a place for investment. I think I'd like to talk only that much, and I request, I thank them for sponsoring this, and I request Ashish to make his opening remarks.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Naushad. And welcome to all of you. Today this event is organized by three events, three chambers directly, Indian Merchants Chamber, IACC and BCAS. So welcome to all the members and delegates. With this I would like to start the introduction of our speaker and the event. This is a couplet which says, Gar Firdaus Barroi Zameen Ast, Hami Asto, Hami Asto, Hami Ast. This means that if there is a heaven on earth, it's here, it's here, it's here. So said Emperor Jahangir in the 17th century when he visited Kashmir for the first time. Another shayar which I just read over the weekend on Kashmir was, Thehr kahi hai waqt ki chaal, chaal chinar ki chhaav mein, ruk jate hain tum lamhe khushhal, dal jheel ke phailaav mein, nazar lag gayi insaan ki khwahishon ki, jannat ke is gaav mein. So I think that's really, nazar lag gayi thi ek tarike se. But that was all history. In the current milieu, Kashmir has been on the boil since 1947, the Muslim-dominated state with an indecisive Hindu ruler to join the Indian Confederation gave an opportunity for armed conflicts by Kabulis, the tribesmen and military action by Pakistan in 1948, 1965, 1971 and in the Kargil War of 1999. The heaven has since then seen civil terrorists and armed disturbance in some form or the other at regular intervals. To keep the peace and tranquility intact, the Indian government has enacted Article 370 as a temporary transitional and special legislative provision for the state with powers of having a separate prime minister, a separate flag and a separate legislative governance system for its need. This special status was not an anomaly in the history of international politics and constituents in US and China also gave provisions for special status for certain regions that are neither against the federal character or the unitary scheme. However, in Kashmir, the issue of a greedy neighbor who wanted to gobble up the state through a complex web of scheming, politicization and radicalization of local populace against the Indian government and its governance was sown and has constantly been abetted. This situation thus has entailed a military presence much to the challenge of economic, military and nationalistic structure all through. The overt and covert acts of terrorism and violence by the neighbor on some pretext or the other have kept the state on an edge. The end result being that economically the state lags behind with no major industry or service sector. The tourism sector, which used to employ large local populace, has taken a beating with growing militancy, so much so that only tourists we see is the local population. There been a long-standing demand for abrogation of Article 370 coupled with Article 335A so that the spirit of Ek Nishan, Ek Vidhan and Ek Pradhan in consonance with the federal structure of the country. It is also with intent that the state joins the mainstream of development. the state contentious interpreting Article 370 and Article 35A in conjunction has since been abrogated on 5th August 2019 in a bold move by Modi 2.0 government. It has given the hope that apart from restoring the Kashmiriyat, the term to denote the cultural and social amalgamation between local communities of Kashmir, the India's only state to have a full-fledged four natural seasons of autumn, winter, spring and summer, and which is endowed with nature's bountiful of flora and fauna, will find an economic progress which can alleviate the economic suffering which currently the vast populace is enduring. The state economy is primarily service-based and agri-oriented. It is hoped that with the vast natural resources base would enable JNK to develop land for cultivating major fruits. With varied agro-climatic conditions, the scope for horticulture is significantly high in the state. Food processing and agro-based industries would again thrive in the state. JNK has an ideal climate for floriculture, enormous assortment of flora and fauna. The state has India's largest tulip garden that will attract tourists both Indian and international. JNK's handicrafts are world famous and the traditional handicraft industry has the potential to emerge as a large industry. Due to its large employment base and exports potential, the industry is all set to receive priority attention of the government. The state is also famous for small-scale and cottage industries such as carpet weaving, silk, shawls, basketry, pottery, copper and silverware, papier-mâché and walnut wood. The cottage and handicrafts industries provided direct and gainful employment to around 340,000 artisans. The state is a leading producer of saffron, apples and walnuts, and which can serve the domestic and export needs of the country. The state, which was a tourist destination and considered as the Switzerland of the East, with several films being shot in the beautiful locales of the state, can be revived once again. Recently in the US Howdy Modi event, a group of Kashmiri pundits met Prime Minister Modi and thanked him on behalf of 7 lakh pundits for his bold and swift action of unifying Kashmir and India in totality. As I hand over the floor to our honoured and highly decorated military officer, Lieutenant General Hasnain, let me end with a simple wish. Let the Kashmir tulips bloom again, cheerfully and colourfully on our land, and the hearts as we regain our lost paradise. Thank you.
I thought usually you normally hear a person before giving over.
Yeah, even before saying
if it is worth it, then you give over.
Thank you. Thank you.
Forward to hearing from you. Thank you.
Audio check. Can you just hear me at the back?
Yeah.
Quite well, otherwise. I am known to be a loudmouth otherwise. The one thing, of course, that I can expect always in the corporate world is that you will stifle the personality of a military commander. You know, normally I always believe in maneuver, having a lot of space for maneuver, but I find here I'm a little constricted. So I will try and speak from here. I'm not used to speaking sitting down ever. I always speak standing, but I'll try and see if I can change my style today a little bit. In the middle, I may just stand up and take a walk around, right? By way of introduction, I don't think the introduction really was done. My name is Atta Hasnain. I'm not known for any great things in life. The only thing which I have done majorly in my career is that I served about 21 years in Kashmir. And 17 years, almost every rank I've been there. I've been decorated at almost every rank in Kashmir. I have an officer of mine sitting here, Colonel Bishnoi, from my regiment and one of my staff officers. Why don't you stand up and show yourself?
Thank you so much.
He was my manager of staff duties at Baramula when I was commanding the division in 2007-8 out there. The other thing great which I find in this room is on the left side I find a huge clock. Amazing. In India you go anywhere today and take a talk, nowhere do you find a clock. Because no one is time bound, no one has anything to do with time. I'm so happy that there's a clock here which you can keep looking at. Of course, other ways of surprise. Nushad surprised me just now because I was under the impression that I would speak my mind for a fair amount of time, and then I was told that there are 30 minutes only to speak. But what I just find is that in the corporate world, you can also have the flexibility to change time immediately. So he made it 60 minutes. Now, so that entirely depends on your level of interest. What I want to bring to you is Kashmir in a different way. You read, you hear every night, you see Arnab Goswami screaming his head out every other night. You don't find me on his channel. You'll find me on other channels every other day. But those are the places from where you don't get the perspective. I'm going to give you from a slightly different, in a different way. From the military perspective, number one. Number two, explaining to you on maps. Because most people in India have no idea where Kashmir is. And I want to, at the end of this talk, I want you to have Kashmir emplaced in your mind in different ways. The whole structure of Kashmir. And I hope I will be able to achieve in doing that. Okay, let me start. I always start my talks with a dedication to the unknown soldier and all those who have laid down their lives for the nation, while we can sit here and discuss in peace. It takes a lot. It takes a lot to command these soldiers. It takes a lot to lose these soldiers in battle. This is not a lecture. It's not a lecture. You will find me in different avatars here. This is one of the most tragic ones. Every other day, as the overall commander in Kashmir, you do this terrible duty of going and laying a wreath on the coffin of a soldier who's just passed away in a battle with the terrorists, or on the line of control, or under climatic conditions. And you have some very severe threats in Kashmir under climatic conditions. It cannot be situational, this talk to 5th of August. It has to be much more. It needs to delve into the past, the present, and the future. And it premises on a basic understanding that most of you are aware of what 370 and 35A are all about. But let me put this in perspective to summarize it. 370 was the article in the Indian Constitution, which primarily empowered Jammu and Kashmir to have a constitution of its own, gave it an element of exclusivity, did not extend the execution of Indian laws to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. One of the implications of that, we have to enact the Armed Forces Special Powers Act 1990 Jammu and Kashmir so that the Indian Army can function in Jammu and Kashmir. Right? That is one of the implications of that. 35A is different. 35A was an act primarily empowering the Legislative Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir to make laws to define who is a citizen of Jammu and Kashmir and thereby define property ownership laws, etc. So these are the two laws which gave an element of exclusivity to Jammu and Kashmir. There are laws in Uttarakhand, there are laws in Manipur and Nagaland, there are laws in Himachal Pradesh, similarly for property rights particularly. But these have not come under focus. These have come under focus in Jammu and Kashmir for various reasons. Jammu and Kashmir is a border state, number one. It was exploited by our adversary, by Pakistan on the other side. And by having this exclusivity, it has allowed Pakistan to focus on an element that Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir is still a unfinished agenda of the partition. We have more on this a little later. So on 5th of August, everything changed. The policy changed on the 5th of August, but before we come to the main conditions under which it changed. Let me remind you, day before yesterday, we heard Prime Minister Narendra Modi at Houston. Howdy Modi. The only thing which I was missing there, Mr. Modi didn't come with a Stetson. I wish he had come with a Stetson. He should have worn a Stetson, he would have looked very good. And I wish Trump had also done the same thing. It would have looked very nice. But it was a gala, great affair. Most of you may not probably recount that it was the second monthly anniversary. It was 60 days after Trump met Imran Khan. Most of you have probably forgotten that. The 22nd of July, Imran Khan met Trump. That was the time when Afghanistan was live. And the issue was happening that the Americans wanted to withdraw from Afghanistan. Trump was looking towards his second term, the commencement of his election campaign, and a full pullout from Afghanistan would have empowered, enabled him that much more. Imran Khan, Pakistan is an essential element of that strategy. And therefore, while all these talks were going on, in the end, he let out a small thing. He said, if you wish, I can mediate on Jammu and Kashmir. We don't know whether he wanted to mediate or meditate, we don't know. Right? A lot of people said, he actually said meditation. But it sent out a lot of messages. Immediately it was evident that Pakistan was empowering itself all over again to restart the whole game in Jammu and Kashmir. So let me take you to the situation just prior to 5th of August. Between 22nd of July 2019 and the 5th of August, a lot of things happened. One of them was this press conference. Kamalji Singh Dhillon, my ex-commander of my 7th sector, when I was the corps commander, he was a brigadier at that time. Now he's commanding the corps. This is the Jammu and Kashmir DG Police, and this is the Additional Director General of the CRPF. This year, despite Pulwama, despite Balakot, which happened on 27th of February, if you remember, we were having a very stable summer. One of the very stable summers. And this is the usual occurrence in Jammu and Kashmir every fourth year. Most things in Kashmir happen in 3 year cycles. 16 Burhan Wani, 17, 18 Operation Orlok. 3 years in continuation, Kashmir was tired. The stamina in Kashmir runs out in 3 years normally. And the fourth year is a stable year. 2017-19 is a stable year. One of the prime reasons besides this as to why this was a stable year was because the government decided to change tack completely. In fact, much of this what I'm speaking now, we'll find it coming in this talk further up also. All this while, in the last 30 years since 1989, when Pakistan decided to launch what is called the proxy hybrid war, and I'll explain that to you, what is the meaning of that. Proxy hybrid war in 1989, when it started it. Our strategy was right from the beginning, kill the terrorists. So every year we kill terrorists. Now let me give you in terms of statistics. In the year 2001, we killed 2,100 terrorists in that year. Huge number. That's the largest we killed throughout. In the year 2018, last year, we killed 254. Tenfold down, almost. That means we had reduced the strength of terrorists by various means, putting up the LOC fence, sharpening our intelligence, getting better means of communication, all kinds of things. We killed terrorists. Lots of it. But the problem won't go away. Why? Because the issue is not about terrorists. The issue is about terrorism. And this hardly anyone in India understands. Terrorism is one entity, a manifestation of terrorism. Terrorism is an ecosystem which is run by a combination of different factors. Lots of different factors. For example, the ecosystem is run by overground workers. The very people who are not terrorists, the very people who come and have a cup of coffee with me as a commander there, and in the evening are speaking against me all over, are writing in the media against me, or against the army, or against the country. You've got people on the payroll of the government of India who are functioning as lecturers in the university, but writing in the media against the country. You've got financial circuits all over Kashmir, where a tremendous amount of money is coming from different parts of the world, unchecked, hawala, all kinds of things. Terrorism cannot survive without money. In 2017, for the first time, and let me tell you, the Indian Army has been talking about this for the last, maybe not 30 years, but definitely for the last 20 years. To tell them, we will stabilize the situation in terms of terrorists, but you have to take the next step. No one would take the next step. No one knew how to take the next step. I'm coming closer to telling you that the 5th August has been the next step. But before that, in 2017, someone realized it, that the next step meant many more things. And they started targeting this ecosystem. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen in 2 years. It's going to take you 5 years, 8 years to dismantle this ecosystem. If I go into the depths of explaining to you. But just understand that every time the army has brought the situation under control and left 200, 250 terrorists who we are now tackling,
there has been a resurgence.
Burhan Wani came, killing of Burhan Wani, and you found a resurgence in South Kashmir. Local terrorists coming up all of a sudden, infiltration increasing all of a sudden, money coming in from outside all over, overground work and activity increasing, tremendous influence of propaganda going up. All this makes the ecosystem. This is something which needs to be understood. Of course, Pakistan was also under pressure of the FATF, Financial Action Task Force, the IMF of the United States. The economy is in shambles. To give you an idea, their foreign exchange reserves today are $7 billion. They were looking for bailout packages of $9 billion. The IMF gave them $6 billion. The Saudis and the UAE put together have given them $13 billion over the last 2 years. The Chinese have done similarly. And for your information, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, of which we shall talk, is now virtually defunct. There's no more money coming into it. So all this was the build-up to 22nd of July, and Imran met him, and there was a grand Pakistani plan to reactivate the hybrid war. They wanted to make sure that 2019 and 2020, there's a full reactivation of this entire thing, with Americans looking the other way. These decisions were very momentous, which have just been taken, 5th of August. The decisions have been momentous. Let me just give you one observation. Everyone was expecting that there will be a trifurcation of Jammu and Kashmir. Jammu, Kashmir, Ladakh. It didn't happen. But they did a bifurcation. They created Ladakh without a legislature, a union territory, and Jammu and Kashmir with a legislature, a union territory. To my mind, this is the best decision could have ever been taken. Reason. I mean, there has to be a rational one, what I'm saying. The reason is, Jammu and Kashmir have a linkage with each other. You cannot break that linkage. The solution to Kashmir will have to come through the Jammu route. No one understands the Kashmiri mind better than the Jammuite. People like us who have lived there our life know this very well. We have to get the Jammu people to understand this and ultimately make sure that the stakeholders are the Jammuites themselves, who will ultimately establish peace in Kashmir. More on this a little later. But let's remember, people who think that the decisions of 5th of August have led to what is called resolving the problem of Jammu and Kashmir, please forget it. This is the beginning of a new phase of turbulence. And much depends on how you're going to handle it. That's what I'm going to be talking more about. Where does the problem lie? Remember, for Pakistan, it's an existential issue. Kashmir has been the trigger for everything. The Pakistan army survives completely on that. More on that a little later. Let me just tell you, for example, the Pakistan army. I'm a three-star general of the Indian army. I don't own 1 acre of land, let me tell you. But I speak to a lot of Pakistani generals who joined me in track two dialogues in Bangkok or in Dubai. Each of them, three-star generals, own 90 acres of land on retirement. Farmland. Right. The Pakistani army manufactures everything from baby food to your breakfast cereal. Everything. It's an industry by itself. Why would anyone want to give up this system? Right? Kashmir enabled this. It enables the commercial activation. You read the famous book by Aisha Siddiqa. It's called Military Incorporated. Military Inc. It's entirely about the commercialization of the Pakistan armed forces. Right? So, threats of war. You now see Imran giving out threats of war, nuclear war, you know, building up the terrorist strength inside the valley through infiltration only. Last night, I was speaking on NDTV, people were asking me, General Rawat's recent statement that Balakot has been reactivated, 450 terrorists are sitting in the training camps. What do you think about it? I said, obviously, if I was sitting in Pakistan, I would be doing the same thing. Why would I sit back on my haunches and accept what India has done? Just the removal of Article 317, 35A doesn't mean that from Pakistan's side everything is finished. That Pakistan will make every effort to reactivate it. Externally, there is a new India. Pakistan has realized it very slowly. There's a new India. And our diplomacy in the last 2 months has got us such brownie points. Although you may be talking about a downturn in the Indian economy or anything, but forget it. It is the Indian strategic position today in the world's pecking order, which is getting it what it's getting it. And the fact that Mr. Modi was in Houston and doing what he did day before yesterday is a huge thing for India. Pakistan is under intense pressure, intense frustration, and remember, most incidents that have happened in the past in Pakistan have always happened out of a Pakistani irrational act. Don't apply rationalism to anything which Pakistan does. Remember Kargil? When Kargil happened, I thought Musharraf's plan was the most outstanding plan of initiation. He took us by surprise. Someone should have asked Musharraf, where are you taking your plan? Where is it going to terminate? Musharraf had no idea. The Pakistan army is what I call the world's best conflict initiator and the worst terminator. They have no idea how to terminate a conflict. Right? So therefore, always be prepared for this irrationality. One fine day, no one in the world talks about nuclear weapons as elements of war fighting. Have you ever heard the Indian government or any leader except Rajnath Sahib recently spoke about, and that was a psychological warfare aspect, where he spoke about change of the Indian doctrine. You heard Manohar Parekar saying this in 2016, change of Indian doctrine of no first use. These are all aspects of psychological war. Today we are hearing threats every day from Imran Khan, saying that hamare paas to parmanu hathiyar hai, we will also, we can use this, we will do this, we will do that. These are not what sane nations talk about. What is interesting and what is good, what is very, very heartening to hear and see, is that there is a new psychological dimension being adopted by India today. All these years, in the last 30 years, we have been browbeaten by Pakistan on the psychological front. Information warfare. Pakistan has got an organization called the ISPR. All of you have heard of what the ISI is. Everyone knows what the ISI is. Mumbai, who won't know? Mumbai was attacked by the ISI. What is the ISPR? Can someone tell me? Any person would like to tell me?
We are of ISIS.
Sorry?
We are of ISIS.
Not really. Anyone who has a guess at ISPR? You see, this is the intellectual element of Mumbai. I speak all over the country. I never managed to get an answer from people. What is ISPR? ISPR is the Inter-Services Public Relations Agency. It was set up in 1949 by Pakistan, which meant that Pakistan understood the element of psychological warfare and information warfare as early as 1949. And someone should ask me, sir, what about the equivalent of the Indian Army? Where is our equivalent of ISPR? Yeah. Can Vishnoi, can you tell us? Do we have an ISPR equivalent in our army today?
Sir, we have not.
Roa is not a public relations agency.
I'll cover the answer.
Let me tell you.
IB
is an intelligence agency, ma'am. ISPR is a public relations agency. What I want to tell you is, we have a thing called the ADGPI, Additional Director General Public Information, which is actually the information arm of the Indian Army. But it's an unauthorized organization. The army has raised it on its own by suppressing some other organizations. Which means the government of India for the last 70 years has never understood the importance of information as a weapon system. It's only now that we realize it. It's only now that the government has realized it. And that is why I'm telling you particularly that the psychological dimension adopted by India is now coming of age. And that is why you're winning brownie points in your diplomacy, in your outreach to the world. Internally, the challenges are very unpredictable. The ecosystem is still prevalent. It needs far more focus to dismantle. The polity is completely dismantled. Where is the National Conference? Where is the PDP? Where is the People's Conference? You have no party left. At the moment, no local party left. You only have the Congress and the BJP. I don't foresee when the elections can take place in Jammu and Kashmir in future. Although this has been a great decision, but ultimately, democracy is in a country which we boast of democracy. We have said in Houston the other day, two largest democracies of the world. Ultimately, democracy is what got us brownie points in Kashmir in 1996. Within 7 years of the commencement of the insurgency militancy, 1989 to 1996, and we introduced elections in 1996. But I'm fearful as to when can we introduce elections, because the next step is going to be delimitation, and then rebuilding of polity. There are all kinds of options being spoken about Panchayati Raj and things like that. I don't know how far we are going to go on that. So these are some of the things which you have to keep in mind, and just remember, we have always said the Kashmiri was alienated, the local Kashmiri, and those, the Kashmiri Muslim south of the Pir Panjal up to the Chenab Valley. Always we have said it was alienated. By taking this action on the 5th of August, we have not de-alienated him. We have not de-alienated him. So this alienation is still very high. We have to find ways of ensuring we do the de-alienation. If ultimately we have to emerge in winners from this momentous decision, which took a tremendous amount of courage to take, then we have to look at all this holistically. Just to define what is the ecosystem for you, because since I've spoken about the ecosystem, this is what ecosystem means. It's a proxy war ecosystem at the nexus of politics, nexus, media, shady third sector organizations. It could include NGOs, lawyers, academics, intellectuals, bankers, I mean, any number of domains put together, who are all above ground, who are not terrorists, but functioning in support of the anti-national elements. Okay, I did promise to you to take you back to geography. I want you to know, from this map, only one element. Although on this map one can talk for hours, I just want you to look at Pakistan. Let's not live in a fool's paradise to say that Pakistan is an unimportant country. Let me qualify why I'm saying this. This is the only piece of real estate in the world which has got five civilizations around it. Count them. The Indian civilization, the Chinese, the Central Asian, the Persian or Iranian, and the Arab. Five civilizations. No country in the world has got this. Everyone has got something to take away and something to give to Pakistan. Let's take an example. The Americans are not even a civilization in the neighborhood anyway. Can the Americans fight a war in Afghanistan ever without the support of Pakistan? Never can it happen. If Central Asia has to ultimately make use of its energy crucible, then the energy resources which come out of Central Asia have to find their way to the ocean. The only route by which they can find their way to the ocean is this route. Until Iran remains a pariah to the world, this is the only route by which it can come. The Chinese to scuttle the possibility of the Indian Navy, the strength of the Indian Navy in the Indian Ocean here on what is called the Malacca Syndrome, the Chinese have decided to access through the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, One Belt, One Road, through Pakistan. And we can carry on and on. Pakistan is the country which neighbors Iran. In 1979, when the Iranian Revolution took place, Saudi Arabia virtually perceived that the Shia element of Islam would probably become the predominant element unless something was done to stop Iran. One of the ways of doing it was to promote Wahhabi Islam in Afghanistan and Pakistan. That's what they did from 1979, 1980 onwards. That was where the start point of Islamic radicalism, or what you call today violent extremism, started from there. Did that. So, though you can't say that Pakistan is an unimportant country, strategically a very important country. And therefore, whatever we do, we may win brownie points today strategically around the world. Let me tell you, in geopolitics, there are no such things as permanent friends and no permanent enemies. It's always interest-based relationships which exist between nations. This map you won't get anywhere, so just pay a little close attention to this. To understand what the borders of Jammu and Kashmir are, this is the whole state of Jammu and Kashmir. In 1994, the government of India or the Indian Parliament passed a resolution, joint parliamentary resolution. All parties came together to say that every piece of territory shown in different colors here belongs to India. This was only restating the instrument of accession, 26th of October 1947, by which the Maharaja of Kashmir had handed over Jammu and Kashmir to India. In 1994, we restated it because the world was getting suspicious about this whole thing. And Pakistanis' claims were getting a little more spreading at that time. Now, this is the territory which is in our control at the moment. So let me explain to you the borders first and then the regions. Or the regions first. This is Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. Only a sliver of territory, nothing more. But this is Gilgit Baltistan. Technically, this whole territory is also called Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. POK, right? This is Shaksgam. The Shaksgam Valley, which has been handed over by Pakistan illegally to China to construct first the Karakoram Highway and now the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Right? It's an illegal handover which has taken place. This is the Siachen area. And if I have time at the end, I'll explain Siachen to you. This is the Aksai Chin area. It's under Chinese control. Parts of it under Chinese control. Let's look at the borders. And these are the names you hear every day. It may not strike you what really are the implications of the terminologies. This is the international border. You have international border also in Gujarat, in Rajasthan, in Punjab, everywhere. But this international border is a little different. Pakistan does not recognize this border. They call it the working boundary. Because this is the erstwhile border between Punjab, the original state of Punjab, and Jammu and Kashmir. And Pakistan thinks this is not a settled boundary. India claims it is a settled boundary. This is the place where all the problems have been taking place since 2015-16, where a lot of infiltration, lots of firings. Why? This is the Hindu-dominated area. Jammu, near Jammu. Jammu, Samba, Vijaypur, on the route to Pathankot, this is the area. And Pakistan's aim was to harass the Hindu population here at that particular time, to bring in communal issues within the rest of India. Right, leave out the valley and target this particular segment. This is the purple line you see here. Traditionally, everywhere the purple line is always the line of control. What is the line of control? And what is the difference with the international border? This line of control is a delineated line. Both countries agreed to it. It's surveyed on the map and on the ground itself. But the only difference here is that the two armies are eyeball to eyeball. On the international border, you will not find armies at eyeball to eyeball. In fact, you will find no army at all. On the international border, you will find border security force. Right? On the LOC, you will only find the army. And there's one old understanding here. It's called grabbers keepers. He who grabs a piece of territory keeps it. So which means 24/7, 365 days of the year, you have to be alert. Otherwise, someone is going to come and grab your territory. You have bat actions, border action teams, a patrol of yours of 6 men, 8 men in the morning dominating the line of control fence, make it targeted by a bat, border action team comprising of Pakistani special forces and some elements of well-trained terrorists, beheading incidents, etc. All this has been happening on the line of control, right? And then you have what is called the actual ground position line or the AGPL 121 kilometers. This is a new line, come up in 1984. This is the Siachen area, of which I'll explain to you separately. This is the most interesting. The line of actual control. Now, this is the LOC and this is the LAC. Remember, LAC is neither delineated nor designated. From 1993, China and India have been trying to come to a common understanding of what the alignment of the LAC is. Till today, we have not come to the understanding. So, India's perception is that the LAC runs here, and China's perception is that the LAC runs here. So all the time, every summer, you will find Indian patrols will start going here and the Chinese patrol will start coming here. So you're going to find a clash of patrols every summer. It will keep happening. One of the major reasons, at the cost of time, let me explain one of the major reasons why China prefers to keep it this way is that they want these clashes every summer. So that your attention as the Indian public, as the Indian armed forces, remains rooted. It remains rooted to your border here, to the Himalayan border. While actually, China's weakness, greatest weakness, and India's greatest strength lies in the ocean here. Do you realize that we can stop Chinese, complete Chinese container traffic? We can stop all the supplies, 80% of China's energy supplies goes through from here. Imagine if the size of the Indian Navy is what it should be. Can you imagine the threat to China, the Chinese economy? What the Chinese want you to do is keep rooting your strength here. Put all your economy, put all your money into the army. While actually you should be putting it into the Navy. That is the reason for it. Okay, now your attention from here. From here, let me take it to another place. How many of you have been to the valley? Can you? Oh great, some people have been there. Let me take you on a virtual tour. This is a fantastic painting by a man called Sarabjit Singh from Chandigarh. I've used this to actually all his paintings. It is from his paintings that I actually understood the entire layout, the complete map layout of Jammu and Kashmir from Ladakh downwards. In fact, from starting from Xinjiang downwards, you have to understand the different ranges. So this map, this photograph has got certain very important ranges here. The Pir Panjal range, for example. The Pir Panjal range comes from Muzaffarabad, from here, it comes down here. The Kishtwar range meets it here. This is the Kishtwar. The Great Himalayan range, which extends right into eastern India. The beginning of the Great Himalayan range is from here. From the Pamirs, it comes down here. And this is the Shamsha Valley range, which is the crown of the Kashmir Valley. Anyone been for the Amarnath Yatra? Oh, great. Glad to see that. That's where Amarnath is. You'll be happy to know, I never fail to inform an audience that as an Indian Muslim, I have done this Yatra 8 times. Yeah. Four times I led the Yatra. I was the first man who did the darshan there. First man. People think in India, a Muslim will not go up and do darshan of Lord Shiva. I can tell you the entire story of Lord Shiva and Parvati. Right? Every time the Amarnath Yatra starts, every year, I write the story for the media to remind the country what the whole pilgrimage is all about. Most people don't know. The Indian Army is a very strange army. Very, very strange army. I love to use these opportunities to explain to my audiences. I was the only Muslim in a completely Hindu regiment. We both come from Garhwal Rifles. Pure Hindu regiment. Garhwal Rifles is from Uttarakhand. My father belonged to the same regiment. He was also a general in the Indian Army. Right? And I can tell you, Sunday morning when we have the mandir of the unit, and me, I am the commanding officer of the unit. You will never find an occasion when the prayers can start without I coming there, me coming there, my wife and I will hold the thali, puja ki thali, only then the mandir will start. But then at the same time, also understand that you have Sikh officers, Rajput officers, Bihar officers who are commanding Muslim troops. 130, 140 Muslim troops were put together and the Chauhan, they say, in command of Khans and Muhammad Ali's. Do you know that in Ramzan, the Chauhan will keep 30 rozas. Throughout the year, he will read 5 namazas with his troops. This is the essence of our army. And that is something which Pakistan can never understand. People outside can never understand. This is the greatest strength of our army. I thought I must just use this to convey this little element to you. Now, on this particular thing, this is the purple line is the line of control.
Sir, but keep repeating this point at all Muslim gatherings.
Sorry?
Keep repeating this point.
Madam, this is the 365th time I am saying this, let me tell you this. You may not have heard it. Please go on to YouTube and see it. You must see it on YouTube.
Sir, Times of India front page.
Okay. Since you mentioned it, very good you mentioned it, madam. Nawazuddin Siddiqui from Mumbai in October 2016 went back to Muzaffarnagar to take part in the Ram Leela. Every year he used to take part in Ram Leela and he used to do the role of Ram. That year, the local people said, "You're a Muslim, how can you be Ram?" They refused. So he tweeted. He tweeted and said, "All my life I've done it and now I've been refused." I picked up his tweet. And I did exactly what you said, Mr. Mahar. Next morning, Times of India takes 21 days to publish an article. When I sent it to them at 4 o'clock in the evening, they published it next morning. It only said one thing.
When the nation is in trouble, when the nation does not know what to do, look at its own army. It will give you all the answers. Never have I ever felt that I'm a Muslim in the army, or a Hindu, or a Christian, or anything like that. I'm only one thing. I'm an Indian. Thank you for bringing that up. But let me take you back here. You know, on this map, a lot can be explained on the current situation. In the last couple of years, you see, Kashmir Valley is this, and South Kashmir is this. The situation in North and South Kashmir keeps exchanging. For the last 6-7 years, it is South Kashmir which is burning. What is South Kashmir? Why is it burning? This is the area where you have the best apple. The Amri apple comes from here. The most educated public, the best lawyers, the white collar workers, everything is here. The best grain comes from here. Everything else put together, one more thing comes from here. Ideology. This is the place where the headquarters of the Jamaat-e-Islami Kashmir exists. And most people think that it exists in Srinagar, actually it exists in Kulgam. And this is where, over a period of time, this area, and extending into the north, in 20-25 years, this area has been converted from the traditional Sufi culture to what is called the Ahle Hadith culture. Why did it happen? Why did it happen? When people like me were there, when people like Arun Bishnoi were there, why did we allow it to happen? Because none of us had an understanding. We said, we are from the Indian Army, we are irreligious. We have nothing to do with religion, nothing to do with faith. And we felt very proud about it. Not realizing that under our eyes, the whole scenario was changing here. 1100 mosques, the Kashmiri clergy was turned over, and you found the clergy from Central UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh being brought there. And the Ahle Hadith, the Wahhabi form of Islam, came to Kashmir where it was a strict Sufi order. And you know what the Sufi order is all about. If you go to Ajmer Sharif, you realize it yourself. It happened because we had no idea about the meaning of what is hybrid war. And I'll come back to explain to you what a hybrid war in a minute. This is the line of control in the north through which all the infiltration takes place. In the last, yesterday's statement by the Jammu Kashmir Police DG says 45 to 60 terrorists since 5th of August have infiltrated into Kashmir. That's a big number. It's a big number, 45 to 60. The question a lot of people will ask is, why is the Indian Army so lax that it allows 45 to 60 terrorists to come through? Let me tell you, you try and sit in ambushes here, even at night, at any time. You can put your right hand out, a man will go past your hand, you will not be able to see him. It's that dark. Terrible land, terrible terrain, raining at night, snowing at different times. We've got the improvements, we've got a lot of technology, but with all the technology we can restrict infiltration, we can never make it zero. Very difficult to make it zero. At the moment, Pakistan is in the process of trying to fill up North Kashmir, because North Kashmir is empty. And they're going to the extent of even infiltrating a few Pakistan Army SSG commandos. They did it in 1999, they're doing it again now. Why? Because this area is bereft of leadership at the moment. No leaders at all left. The best way of targeting a terrorist infrastructure is, don't go after the terrorist, go after the terrorist leader. There were times when I was the overall commander, I would go to my units in Baramulla and Sopore and places like that and tell them and warn them, if you kill a normal common terrorist, I will come and get after your life. I want you to kill only this leader. Then they would focus only on that leader. And eliminate him. He's been here for 10 years. If you can eliminate the Pakistani terrorist leader here, then what happens? Automatically the structure collapses. That's exactly what we did in 2010, 11, 12. And it lasted till 2015, 16 until Burhan Wani came up at that time. So, and down south here, this is all local militancy. These are all locals. Burhan Wani came from a place called Tral, which is here. So on this map, I just wanted to explain to you that these are some of the dynamics here. This is the Peer Punjab area, and south of this is Jammu. Udhampur Jammu is this area. This is Poonch, this is the Haji Peer Bulge, the famous place which we captured in 1965, but we were forced to give it away for various reasons. Okay. Short of time, but this is a thing that takes a lot of time to explain. These photographs create havoc in the minds of any Pakistani soldier. Disgrace, military disgrace, 93,000 prisoners. Hand it over. I always say that the best time to have dissolved 35A and 370 was 1972. After 71, at the Shimla Agreement, we should have said, okay, everything agreed, 370 and 35A are hereby removed. Jammu and Kashmir is a part of India, no more negotiable. It would have resolved all your problems. But it's not so easy. If you do a deeper analysis and assessment, you'll realize Indira Gandhi was probably thinking of this. Could not take that decision. Indira Gandhi was a powerful, very strong leader. She couldn't take the decision at that time. Perhaps because the Soviet Union said you can go up to this much, but not beyond. Under the Indo-Soviet Treaty of 20-year Indo-Soviet Treaty, if you remember, the Treaty of Friendship, which is why the Americans kept off from the USS Enterprise and everything, the Americans kept off the shores of India. The Soviets had warned India, you can go up to this point, but not beyond. And that is why perhaps the decisions were not taken at that particular time. Let me say, immediately within 5 years of 72, of the Shimla Agreement is all about bilateralism. That India and Pakistan will resolve their problems bilaterally. The UN has no role. Internationally, no other nation has a role to mediate between us. And that's the reason why we always frown upon this word mediation. But in 1974, we tested the nuclear device, the first nuclear device, the Pokhran. The response to that was by Bhutto was this. We'll eat grass, we'll eat leaves, but we'll have our bomb. They have their bomb. By all kinds of covert means and cheating, they had their bomb. And the policy they followed through the 80s and the 90s before 1998, when it became finally, when everything became overground, the policy they followed was a policy of what is called ambivalence. One day you say, I've got the bomb, the next day you say, I don't have the bomb. The third day you say, I have the bomb, the fourth day you say, perhaps I've got the bomb. So you keep the world guessing. Pakistan's greatest strategy right through the last 70 years has been what is called the strategy of denial. I've not done it. In Kargil, some people have come on the heights. They're not my soldiers. They're terrorists. They're militants. And the whole world was believing it initially. Deny everything. And India, we are the most truthful people. We don't know how to use denial as a strategy, but I think we are learning it now. A very important aspect to understand Pakistan's mindset on Kashmir, which will explain to you where the future will lie. Ziaul Haq came to power in 1977. What did he do? In 77, he said, first thing, we have to take revenge for what happened in 71. Retribution. But for retribution, Pakistan is unable to match India's conventional army. It's too big. Nor can it match India's economic strength. Today, where can it match India's economic strength? $420 billion against $7 billion of foreign exchange reserves. If you just keep that parameter in mind. So, therefore, there has to be something else. The first is Pakistan must go nuclear. By going nuclear, all asymmetry is set aside. All asymmetry, conventional asymmetry gets set aside. Second thing, it must befriend a rich Islamic state who can bankroll the terror, the nuclear program. And that was done with Saudi Arabia. And await an opportunity to exploit India's fault lines. Fault lines of India are many, as we are aware. Religious being the biggest one of them. Casteist, linguistic, regional, linguistic. Now you suddenly see in the last few days, linguistic suddenly. So, they said our opportunity will come. The opportunity came much faster than anyone thought. It came in 1989. From 1979 to 1989, Pakistan fought the war in Afghanistan on behalf of Saudi Arabia and the United States. It led an army of transnational mercenaries and brought the Soviet Union to its knees. Learned tremendous lessons there. All those lessons it learned in the 80s there came back to be implemented in 1989 and beyond in Kashmir. What were these? And this is an example which is very interesting to see why in 89 Pakistan succeeded in doing what it wanted to do. There's a YouTube video of mine which is going around about 11 minutes, I think, which I spoke at a Kashmir's Pandit Samaj recently. It's got about 2 million hits in 3 days. It talks about this. Let me explain you very briefly, because you will get a very good strategic idea of what India was in 1989 and what India is perhaps in 2019. Whenever you see a strategic issue come up before you, the best way to examine it is by looking at these five parameters. The first one is political. Now, if you compare, in 1989, Rajiv Gandhi's 440-seat majority had dwindled down, he had lost power. You had a VP Singh government, a Chandrasekhar government, and you had total turbulence in the center. Which means when you have political instability at the center, you are always strategically weak. Today you have got a 303-seat majority. Look at diplomatic. In 1989, who would India go to complain on anything at all? Or inform the world? The whole world was in a tizzy. There was no world order. The Soviet Union was collapsing, the Cold War had ended, the Berlin Wall had fallen, and the Soviet Union was withdrawing from Afghanistan. Pakistan was ruling the roost in Afghanistan. And that's the time when the transnational Mujahideen were being inducted into India. So, diplomatically, today you see India's position in 2019 diplomatically, where you're finding Houston taking place. Good to compare this. Militarily, 100,000 troops of the Indian Army were sitting in Sri Lanka. Appalling. Punjab was burning, height of insurgency in Punjab. Nagaland and Manipur were still burning. And we had an exercise on our borders by Pakistan called Zarbe Momin going on, in reply to General Sundarji's famous brass tacks. So everywhere we were militarily under pressure. Today, I think we are far more comfortable, although we've got a big deployment of the Indian Army in Kashmir. Economically, we were coming down in 1990, end of 1990, we had come down to $1 billion of foreign exchange reserves. Today, Pakistan is 7 times better. They got $7 billion. We have got $420 billion. But our economy, yes, it's a problem, although I'm sure we will overcome this in the near future. Socially, we have the longest lasting agitation, social agitation, the Mandal agitation going on in 1989, 89, 90, 91, carried on. Now, when you combine all this together, then I sometimes play at it in my mind that the Pakistan DG ISI must have definitely gone to the Prime Minister. By that time, Zia was already dead. He must have gone to the Prime Minister and told the Prime Minister that this is the golden opportunity. Let's get into Kashmir. Prime Minister Benazir Bhutto was that time not mature enough, did not have full experience. She probably denied, initially she did not give permission. But then they prevailed upon her and said, if you don't do it now, you will never get an opportunity. And that's how the whole game of Jammu Kashmir started in 1989. Which is why I brought this out in the Kashmiri Pandit Samaj to tell them why the Kashmiri Pandits became the instrument. 19th of January 1990, the Kashmiri Pandits became the first instrument of this strategic policy of Pakistan to convey that it was important for Pakistan to create a linkage from the Middle East to Kashmir, an Islamic linkage to Kashmir, to support the Kashmiri Muslim population. And that message would carry the day as far as militancy against India was concerned. Pakistan was very smart about one thing. It did not fight a normal war. It launched a hybrid war. Now, most people in the world are unaware, in India particularly, are unaware of the types of war that you can have. This is one of the smartest ways of fighting. It combines different ways of fighting. Pick and choose your domains to fight. And the thing in it is it provides flexibility. It provides longevity. And it provides limited exhaustion of resources. So you can fight a proxy war, like Iran is fighting in Yemen, a proxy war. Through the Houthis, through the Zaydi Houthis, Russia is fighting a proxy war in Ukraine. Right? There are different proxy hybrid wars which are going on in different parts of the world. And we have been one of the people subjected to for the longest time, almost 30 years.
one solution in this. Remember, the solution to hybrid war is only one. You have to adopt what is called the all of government approach. Every department of government has to be at war. Who in India has ever realized this? Everyone in India says, ladai, war, army. Who else can fight a war? Not realizing this is not conventional war. This is hybrid war. It's a completely different form of war. If you want to understand it, see, there are four elements which create this kind of war. You require human resources, for which you require terrorists, overground workers, ideologues. The ideologues are generally the Maulvis, the priests, clergy, local recruiters, media. The media is very important. Perhaps you may not realize it. Srinagar publishes more English newspapers every morning than Mumbai does. Right? Mumbai doesn't publish 30 English newspapers. Kashmir publishes 30 English newspapers in the morning. At safe houses, logisticians, safe houses, where without guns, ammunition, the IED which blew up in Pulwama, 350 kilos of explosive. Finances, without this, nothing can happen. The simplest example, the ISIS fought in Iraq. Till the time their money ran out, they had $500 million which they had looted from the Mosul refinery. They ran the refinery and sold oil to all the countries with whom they were fighting. You see, warfare is a very strange thing. There's an economics going on behind the scenes. When oil was at $40 a barrel, they were selling oil to the very countries they were fighting against at $25 a barrel. Right? And making money, and that was helping them to fight. So there was an ecosystem there. That is the kind of ecosystem which existed here. Ideology, extremist Islam, rabble-rousers, Urdu media, everyone from the mosques. At the height of the Burhanwadi agitation, the mosque was the place with the held the power. 11 and 12 year old boys were running this agitation. And they would force the civil servants to come in the morning, report at the mosque before they go to work, and report and tell them how many members of their family were taking part in the stone throwing agitation. It is that kind of a thing which was happening. All from here. Now, what the Indian Army was asked to do, or what it volunteered to do, was kill these guys. What about all this? For 30 years, we have done nothing about it. If you ask, we should do counter-radicalization and de-radicalization. Who knows how to do counter-radicalization and de-radicalization? Any audience I go to, I tell them, let someone stand up and tell me, what is the difference between a Shia and a Sunni? No one knows. Uneducated about these things. And in the army, the least. Until one fine day, I was tasked by someone, please educate the Indian Army on Islam. Because remember that when you're fighting hybrid wars, this kind of war, you have to understand the cultural terrain of the location where you're fighting it. You can't fight just with weapons. You have to fight with your brain. You have to fight with your knowledge. And that is why cultural terrain is as important as physical terrain. One way of fighting this, the greatest way of fighting this, and I always would tell the government of India this, the greatest way of fighting terror, anything, is political consensus. If today we have a situation where all the parties come together and say, 35A, 370, best decision, we support the government, and please go ahead and do this, I can tell you, you will have never a problem. This happened once in 1994. In 1994, we were under tremendous pressure from the United States, of all countries. Everyone thought Clinton administration was a very friendly administration. It wasn't. The woman who was after our wife was a woman called Robin Raphael. The wife, most people have forgotten this element of history. She was the wife of Ambassador Raphael, the US ambassador to Pakistan, who was killed with Zia in the same aircraft. She always thought that it was Raw who had done this job. And she had an axe to grind with India. And therefore, from 92, 93, 94, India was under intense pressure internationally. And that was the time when the leader of the opposition and the Prime Minister came together. Right? When you have such a situation, when they come together and they said, all parties, both houses of parliament, the Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, came together and passed a resolution, 22nd of February, which said every piece of ground on Jammu and Kashmir, the whole erstwhile state which was under the rule of the Maharaja, belongs to India. This is a message to the world. And we will aspire to get it back. After 1994, the next momentous decision politically has been 5th of August 2009. Right, I'm not going to go into this, this will take too much time, but broadly just have a look at it. One of our greatest weaknesses has been this, strategic communication. Strategic communication is a very sophisticated word for psychological warfare. Propaganda. Right? Communication strategy. And I emphasized in the beginning, we were very weak at it, we have realized it, and I think we are picking up tremendously today. Also remember the last mile. The last mile is when an incidency or a terrorist situation is dying out. The last bit, 200, 300 terrorists will give you the maximum problem. And you will keep trying very, very hard and you will tie yourself in knots. That's exactly what has happened to the Indian Army and to the Indian security system. At the moment, it is India, advantage India. Temporarily, because I don't like to use the word lockdown. At the moment, there are restrictions in Kashmir. Hopefully, 27th of September, when Prime Minister Modi speaks at the UN General Assembly, and after that, Imran Khan speaks there, I hope that will be symbolically a time after which you will find more opening up taking place. Before I sat down to talk, I was shocked to see that my telephone was buzzing and I had a 94190 number ringing, which means 94190 is Kashmir. That means mobile communication from Kashmir was coming to me. There's something that is good which is happening to us. I didn't take the call at that time. Okay. Last two bits. What is India's short-term aim? What should be India's short-term aim? When you look at the short-term, it is 3-4 years. What are the short-term aims? Let me tell you, incidentally, no one has ever defined aims of India. I went back as the corps commander at the last time when I went to Kashmir. I asked everyone, please define what is my task, what is my aim. Everyone kept telling me, kill the maximum terrorists. And that I've been doing all my life. Now as the core commander, is that my task to kill terrorists? Tell me, what is my actual task? No one could tell me. This was my short-term aim. To stabilize the security environment, negate the adversary propaganda. See, I put this so high on the propaganda, so high on it. Promote intra-state integration. Jammu and Kashmir must integrate together. Enable effective governance. That is most important. Where the money coming in must go down to the last man. That has not been happening in Kashmir. Promotion of peace and harmony is the bottom line, for which engagement and outreach, winning hearts and minds, is a necessary aspect of the army's tactical and operational approach. It must become the nation's strategic approach, winning hearts and minds. What is the long-term aim? Incidentally, in 2011, they put me on the Outlook cover. Basically, for my Hearts and Minds program. Hearts and Minds program. And just to tell you symbolically, first thing, when someone told me, sir, what is your Hearts and Minds program? I said, okay, let's start symbolically. The year 2011 will be the year of the Awam. Awam is the people. So we declared 2011 as the year of the Awam. The second message immediately given to the media in 2011 was, do you remember the good old slogan of the army? The slogan of the army said, Jawan aur Awam, Aman hai Mukam. We will not change that slogan to Awam aur Jawan, Aman hai Mukam. Putting the people before the army. We will put the people before us and go out to them, to reach out to them and get them on our side. Returning the dignity and the self-respect to the people. That was our whole aim. Best understood, we trained our men, we trained our officers, we changed our approach, the attitude completely. Within 3 months, I had a call from a journalist of the Indian Express who rang me up from a checkpoint. And he told me, what have you done? he asked me, "General Saab, what have you done?" I said, "Why? Tell me what has happened." He said, "I've been passing this checkpoint for the last 10 years, maybe more. There's never been a time when I've not been abused at this checkpoint. And the rudest of behavior, they have asked me to get down from my vehicle, they've beaten sticks on my vehicle, there are dents on my vehicle." So I said, "What's different today?" He says, "Today, they started the checking by first wishing me Salaam Alaikum." So I said, "Then?" And then they offered me a cup of tea. And they requested me whether they can search the vehicle. So I said, "What did you do?" He says, "I told them, if you have such an attitude, you can search my vehicle every day." You see, when you're in a conflict zone, if you live 20 years in a conflict zone, you'll realize small things add to your self-esteem. Small things will add to your... You cannot imagine this in Mumbai. Sitting in Mumbai, you cannot imagine it. But imagine that you and your family are going out for a movie or going out for a picnic, and you have to pass 5 security checkpoints of the Jammu and Kashmir police. Your fun is not going to be spoiled completely. Okay, people are asking, why are there restrictions? Why is there a communication blackout in Kashmir? I just told you, I think the communication blackout is lifting. But reason, social media, mobile internet, the entire Arab Spring of 2009, not 9, 10, 11, 12, Tahrir Square in Cairo, everything was fought on the basis of social media. Social media is a menace, absolutely. Although I follow Twitter avidly myself, but I use it for more positive purposes. But I find so much of negativity on social media. And you will realize that as soon as this is opened up, I know that my Twitter handle will get filled up with messages from Kashmir of negativity and nothing else. We wanted to avoid that. I think the government of India was correct in one way. You couldn't take a risk on this. You couldn't take a risk. We had risked this in Burhanwani in 2016. We risked it in 2010. We risked it in 9. We risked it in 2008, in the height of the agitations that time. We learned our lessons. And this time, we made sure that we put in enough troops to bring about what is being called a lockdown and stop the communication. That has helped tremendously. The last bit. What could happen once this is diluted? I told you, the ecosystem has been targeted. Since the ecosystem has been targeted, I doubt there can be a resurgence of internal security issues as intense as 2016 or as intense as 2010. Because in 2016, the entire incident, in the entire turbulence took place in the rural areas. Because they had learned their lessons. The urban areas were under the complete control of the police. They went to the rural areas. The police stations got burnt. Police stations got vacated by the police. In 2019, now this time, we flew the troops in, armed police inside, and occupied all the rural areas. And that is why this lockdown has been successful. Let's have a look at it. Let's remember, Pakistan is not going to give up. International acceptance is high for India, but very poor in the international media. Those of you who read the International Herald Tribune, the New York Times, the Washington Post, you have to remember, nothing pro-Indian is being written there. That's where our cultivation has been poor. And I think we are learning our lessons on this. The LOC is likely to be very active. It is very active at the moment. Not of intense firing and shelling, but lots of infiltration attempts every night are going on. Pakistani propaganda will redouble. It's already happened. Much will depend upon the status of Afghanistan. If Trump once again comes into this whole cycle of trying to get the American troops out of Afghanistan after the talks with the Taliban have collapsed, once again the importance of Pakistan is going to increase. And as soon as the importance of Pakistan increases in the eyes of the United States, Pakistan's manner of looking at Kashmir is different. So that is what we have to be careful about. India must work on a professional hearts and minds game. Very, very important. You cannot say, you can't say this is someone else's job. This is the job of the government of India. And now that it's a union territory and we have the direct union oversight on the territory, I think this time it will be much, much better. Pakistan must be kept under pressure of the Pashtun and the Baluch separatism must continue playing upon this at all times. The highest priority, prevent the rejuvenation of the ecosystem. I started with this to tell you that the ecosystem has been partially taken down. This must be completely dismantled and must not allow it to come back again. This is just the what I call the hearts and minds game. A very, very important aspect. Sadbhavna, this Sadbhavna is an Indian Army operation. Four areas that we look at: education, medical, women empowerment, small scale infrastructure, and the fifth thing is national integration. You'll be very happy to know that women empowerment, and the ladies sitting here, you'll be very happy to know. The Indian Army is the only organization in Jammu and Kashmir which had the sense to build toilets for the girl children. There were no toilets for the girls. Now people in the world will say, what is the Indian Army doing building toilets? And I'll tell them, this is hybrid warfare. Right? Our job is not here to kill people only. Our job is to ensure the society remains strong. And the children, the women are the most important element of the society here. The woman is the mother, woman is the daughter, she's the wife, she's the sister, she's the daughter-in-law. She's the sister-in-law. She's the one who takes the maverick male by his neck and makes sure that he does not become a terrorist. That is the way that women have to be always empowered. Right, I've come to 6:20 and I know that all of you have to go back home. Maybe some questions. This is an issue which will take me 5 minutes to explain. If you so wish me to explain, I will explain it.
Yes.
You wish me to explain? Why I'm telling you is that Siachen is an issue which otherwise very few people in India understand. And why are we there? Why are we spending 4 crores a day? Why are we spending 1500 crore rupees a year? What is the reason for this? How did it come about? In 1972, under the Shimla Agreement, we aligned the line of control till NJ 9842 in Ladakh. Here, NJ 9842 is a reference point on a map. Beyond this area here was heights of 21,000, 22,000. And people said, who's going to survive here? There's no one who lives here. There's not a blade of grass which grows here. So why even delineate the line of control? So they all agreed on paper. It was written as, the line of control from NJ 9842 shall flow hereafter, north to the glaciers. Four words were used, north to the glaciers. These four words came back to haunt India, have still haunted India. In 1978, we noticed that the Pakistanis were sending all kinds of patrols and expeditions into this area. So we raised this issue. And the Pakistanis said, their perception of north to the glaciers meant 9842 Karakoram Pass, which meant the entire territory of Siachen Glacier was Pakistani. When India was accosted with this problem, we said, okay, we will lay our claim line. We said, when issues of this kind arise, then every nation who's accosted with this kind of a problem, they usually adopt a methodology called following the watershed principle. The watershed is the imaginary line joining the tops of the mountains. When rain falls in that area, an equal amount of water will flow on both sides of that line. That line is this line, along what is called the Saltoro Ridge. The Saltoro Ridge is mountains going up to 22,000-23,000 feet. Right? So this is how this continued till 1984. It continued from 78 till 1984. In 1984, India finally decided enough is enough. On the 13th of April, we launched a unit in helicopters and landed them here at a place called Bedafonda and occupied it. We beat the Pakistanis to it. Pakistanis could have done the same thing, but we beat them to it. Early in winter, high levels of snow, very difficult survival, very little equipment at that time that we had. The Pakistanis have tried to evict us from this line for the last many, many years. I faced them personally. I commanded my unit in Northern Siachen Glacier. I had 4 or 5 attacks on my battalion at that time. But they couldn't evict us from there. And The one thing which I want you to remember is that every Pakistani you meet internationally, and you are a set of people who travel internationally, everywhere you go around the world, you meet Pakistanis and who will say that we should do a mutual withdrawal from Pakistan, from Siachen. I meet a lot of Pakistani generals every 3 months who tell me, General Sahab, why don't we mutually withdraw from Siachen? I said, what do you mean by mutual withdrawal? They said, you leave your side and we leave our side. I said, well, where are you in Siachen? So, then I asked many times, they said, I have commanded my unit in Siachen. I said, I have commanded my unit in Siachen. Tell me, where have you commanded it? They can never tell me. Because Pakistan cannot even see Siachen. You must remember that this is the Siachen glacier. And the Indian Army is sitting on guarding it from the Vasartoro Ridge. Pakistan is sitting here. They have never admitted to their own public, they have never admitted to their own media that they have lost Siachen. Psychologically, defeat in 1971 and defeat in Siachen was something unacceptable to the Pakistan Army. They made a film for Discovery Channel called Pakistan Army in Siachen. Where is the Pakistan Army in Siachen? And they tell the world we are in Siachen everywhere. So, people in our government in Siachen did not realize it. And then the army had to tell them that mutual withdrawal means that the Indian army will have to leave all these heights and come down. And tomorrow, like Kargil, Pakistan will come and occupy these heights. And you will tell us to go and recapture them. You will lose 10 to 15,000 men to capture them. You want Indian lives to once again do like this? So, sense prevailed in our government and everything was stopped. Now, there is a strategic importance to this place. The broadening, if you don't occupy Siachen, the broadening of the contact between China and Pakistan in the north. If you don't occupy this area of the Nubra Valley cannot be retained by India. We have to pull back behind the southern range here, is called the Ladakh Range. And behind the southern range, the Ladakh Range, is the city of Leh. The worst strategy in the world an army can adopt is to have one range between the capital city of Leh and there. Now is the capital of the Union Territory. So perforce 1500 crore rupees for a nation like ours, which is heading hopefully to be a $5 trillion economy. That much money is just chicken feed. This is what the Sardaro looks like. And this is the last post the Pakistanis occupied. It's called Khair. It was evicted by a 15 or 20 man team led by a man called Brigadier Virender Singh, who no more unfortunately, Veer Chakra, and along with him a man who I would request my audience, on 26th of January every year you will find on your TV screens when the march past is taking place, you will find the Sardar Bana Singh. You will find the Sardar, an old looking Sikh gentleman who will be saluting. Here's the Param Veer Chakra. He's the man who climbed from here all the way here and assaulted and got rid of this. Today it is called Bana Post. It's called Bana Post today. This is the symbol on which the Indian Army functions. When the Indian Army moves into Siachen, every soldier goes past this, salutes and goes up. No fate, all four fates on one board. This is how the soldiers look when they are moving up to Siachen. This is how a helicopter lands there. A helicopter manufactured to land at 13,000 feet is landing at 21,000 feet. Right? And because of that, the dynamics are such, at every place it tries to land, it does a dance before that. A fantastic dance before that. It's a great thing to take a video of that. Right, just in case we have time for a question and answer session, in the army we always believe in doing our staff work, and that means that I also made the questions for you. Right? So, in case you have questions and you find that any of these questions which have not been covered by me, if you find any of them of interest, you are most welcome to shoot them. Thank you very much.
Let's go one by one. Yeah, the lady in the right, come on.
You're talking about Kashmiri pundits.
Yes, because
Let me tell you, Kashmir does not have only Pandits, there are
Kashmiri Rajputs also.
Yes.
Yeah, there are Kashmiri Rajputs. There are Gujars and there are Pahari Hindus also.
Let me tell you first of all, today, the situation in terms of terror is such that you have not had an atrocity against a purely Hindu entity anywhere in the last many years now. The last time it took place was early part of the millennium when you had a terrible incident at a place called Vandama, where a number of Kashmiri Pandits were killed. Why only Kashmiri Hindus? Also the Sikh community. There are 2% of Sikh in Kashmir. The last major incident against the Sikh was in the year 2000. 19th of March 2000, when Clinton was speaking at the Indian Parliament. That same night, the Lashkar-e-Toyba struck and killed 36 Sikhs in Kashmir. Right? And this was at the height when the Indian army was, I mean, we were dominant everywhere, but we couldn't prevent it happening. But today, let me tell you, with strength, at that time when all this happened, the strength of terrorists in Kashmir was 7 to 8,000. Today, the strength of terrorists in Kashmir is 250 to 300. That's all, right? So, the control is far better. In my time, I brought back 1,200 families, Kashmiri Pandit families, to Kashmir. In a place called Visu Camp. I think you know Visu Camp very well. We kept them there. But we haven't been able to take it beyond. We should be able to now, slowly with improving situation, one of the very important aspects is the return of the Kashmiri Pandits. I think safety is there, but risks cannot be taken. Risks cannot be taken. I've had meetings with a lot of Kashmiri Pandit families and people. I take part in a lot of functions of theirs. And I find the younger generation is not very keen to go back. But the older generation who have lived in Kashmir have all got their hearts there. All their properties have been destroyed or been taken over, and that is going to cause a major social turbulence. The next step, if they go back, how are they going to go back to their properties? How are the people who have occupied those properties going to be evicted? This is going to be a major, major issue, which no one wants to touch at the moment. I think it will take quite some time. It will take quite some time to touch issues such as this. At least restore a different kind of a situation with the removal of Article 370 and 35A in terms of overall security, and then start tackling these issues. Yeah. So, sorry, I think you would have to direct that to
me. Yeah, so the person at the back.
Government of India and Government of Kashmir has dossier Kashmir for the national integration work we've been doing there. And probably the only company which never stopped taking tours to Kashmir even during peak of militancy. I thank IMC. I've heard a lot of your on YouTube, and I thank IMC for giving this opportunity to come here to salute you. Day after tomorrow, we are taking about 20 tour operators to meet Amit Shahi to see the next step as to how tourism can be the file driver in getting normalcy back. And we are associated closely with your Sadbhavna through Lieutenant General Patankar, who is a very close friend and mentor. So with Sarab and Sarab,
please tell us when you're taking the next tour, we'll get IMC also to join.
Absolutely. In fact, I told Anand that you should do your convention in Sheri Kashmir Center.
Maybe.
Let me speak on this, because you've touched a very, very important aspect actually on tourism. You see, a lot of people in India, first of all, lack of knowledge. When you start tweeting, when you start sending out messages that now, that very, very awkward thing which happened in Haryana, that message which said, now we can get Kashmiri girls to come and marry our boys. Terrible kind of message. And that is the thing which we are wanting to avoid, that negativism. Second thing is, oh, now Kashmiri property is all ours. Which is essentially what you are taking is the people you are not bothered about, it's the property and it's the land you are bothered about. I think, as a part of governance and a part of restoration of economy, I'll give you an example. In 2011, as the core commander, one of my missions was how to make sure 3,000 crores worth of apple goes out of Kashmir. 3,000 crores. And how do 2.5 million people come as tourists to Kashmir? Now people ask me, are you a general or are you a tourist operator? Are you an agriculturalist? A lot of people have this stupid question to ask me. And I have to educate them and tell them, this is not conventional war. This is hybrid war. And in hybrid war, these are the things I'm looking for. Just remember this basic principle. When money clangs in the pockets of people, they don't throw stones.
Absolutely.
When there's enough money in the pockets of people, no one is going to throw stones around.
Lieutenant General Patankar in Mumbai gave a speech to the
same. Patankar was my
He said that we at Rajarani were doing exactly that, stopping the second generation of Kashmiri youth by giving them employment.
Exactly.
Which easily picked up a
That's the whole idea. That's the whole idea. And since you are involved with tourism, let me tell you, the scope of tourism maximum in Kashmir, don't look at the Dal, don't look at Pahalgam, don't look at Gulmarg, and don't look at Sonamarg. The tourist potential of Kashmir lies in the Peer Panjal, in the Shamshabari, in rural tourism, in winter tourism. These are unconventional aspects of tourism which you will have to exploit in the future.
I'm going to come and have a coffee with you, sir. Absolutely. Thank you very much and salute again.
I don't know how much we can go on because already 6:35. Let's take last three questions, please. Come. Yeah, go ahead.
You want to ask us?
Put the mic. The mic.
Hybrid warfare.
Actually, I have two but very quick ones. First of all is, you know, we're hearing a lot about this Pakistan POK, right? And the great confidence being spelled out about occupation at some stage and taking it back. What, in your opinion, might ensure that this doesn't turn into a rhetoric for long term? That's one question. And the other one was a simple one. Why was it necessary for Ladakh to be separately dealt with?
Well, the last part is the
Ladakh, right? Was it necessary to separate Ladakh?
Okay, so why was this? Okay. Both good, very interesting questions. The first one, POK, should be an expected question in today's any place you discuss Kashmir today. Why? Because we have made it very clear that the issue is no longer Jammu and Kashmir. The issue is now how to return the territories which are under occupation. This is great psychological warfare. And therefore, when Rajnath Sahib talks about this, in fact, it was Mr. Rajnath who was the first person who started speaking about it. I think it was a very sensible decision to get the Defense Minister of India to start speaking about this. It does not mean that we are going to attack POK tomorrow. It doesn't mean that we are going to go to war. General Rawat, of course, every day keeps saying, I'm waiting for the signal to let the government tell me and I will go and pick up POK. Good. Talk about all this. We have been subjected to this psychological warfare by Pakistan for the 30 years. Let's do it back to them for a change. Okay. But at the end of the day, my way of picking out POK back to India is through a sustained 10% growth in India. Economics. Mumbai is your solution. The solution lies in Mumbai, not in Delhi. Solution lies here. You see, the financial capital of the country. You got to ultimately look. Who wants to go to Pakistan with $7 billion of foreign exchange reserve and a negative growth rate? Who would want to go there? Equally, someone would want to come here and say yes. And there are people in POK who are saying that. There are people in Gilgit-Baltistan who are saying it today. There are people in Baluchistan who are saying it. There are people among the Pakhtuns who are saying it. So there is a tremendous fissiparish tendency which is taking place in Pakistan. Keep them under pressure. But equally, I must answer your question on one aspect also. To think that a frittered, broken Pakistan is of advantage to you, please forget it. Let's look at that. Let's see it in a different angle. 24 million people from Syria. Syria imploded. The effect didn't travel to Jordan and to Israel. The effect went to New York, Washington, Brussels, Paris, and London. When 200 million nation explodes or implodes, the effect is only going to come on you. No one else. It's only going to come on you. Therefore, my way of looking at it is a stable but reasonably weak Pakistan, much weaker than India, is of great advantage to you. Okay, Ladakh. You see, I've been very fortunate. I've served in Ladakh in all major parts. Siachen, Kargil, and Eastern Ladakh. All three of them. So I know this very, very intimately, this area. Ladakh is at a limb. The communication to Ladakh is through two arteries. One is through Srinagar and the Zojila access, and the other is to Manali, Manali-Upshi access. Both are open for 6 months in a year. Remaining of the time, until the Zojila tunnel comes up, and the other one, the Rotang tunnel, until the Rotang tunnel comes up. When the two major tunnels are completely stable, then you'll have 24/7 approach to Ladakh. But
You see, in this game of distribution of resources between Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, Ladakh has really lost out. And Jammu has lost out to a great extent. Central oversight has been missing. And you know, this thing of earlier we had a BJP NC government at one time, then we had a Congress PDP, then we had a Congress NC. In this entire game of having a local mainstream party there, somehow it's always been Srinagar based. It's never been Jammu or Ladakh based. So the chunk of the resources have always gone to the valley. Now, I think as a responsible nation, what India needed to do, what Delhi needed to do always, was to keep a central oversight and accountability on the funding which was going on there. Now that it's got a union territory status, Ladakh will have a direct oversight. And J&K similarly will have a legislature of his own, but I'm told by the bureaucrats that 60% of the projects have a direct oversight by people from Delhi.
The MP from Ladakh, what a speech he gave in Parliament, and that probably explains everything. Come on, sir. Yes, sir, please. Achha, you will make a last lady, we'll ask you.
Okay. Assurance, I'll give you.
So my question is very basic. I wanted to ask you, when I hear the mainstream Kashmiri politicians of the television, they talk of political solution. They say the government of India should go for a political solution. Now, you being so familiar with these politicians and the normal common people in Pakistan, in Kashmir, what in your view this political solution mean? What is in their mind for this political solution?
I think on 5th of August, you had the best political solution.
No,
actually, I'm meaning it.
But this is not what they want. What I
no,
want.
No, they may not want it. Yeah. They may not want it.
Sir, my question.
You see, I'll tell you what. Every time what was happening was in 2011, at the end of 2011, I gave a report to the government that we have only got 42 terrorists who have come inside Kashmir by infiltration this year. We have killed any number of terrorists through the year. We have killed 19 major terrorist leaders. The situation is completely stable. Now it is for you to take the next initiative. Nothing happened. 2012 came, 2013 came, nothing happened. In many meetings and conferences in Delhi, people used to keep telling me this, we are looking for a political solution. So when I jotted out my options of political solution, one of them was this, 370 and 35A. And that's exactly what happened on 5th of August. The political solution has been that without doing anything, enacting through the parliament, through a democratic system in the parliament of India, what you have done is you've actually got a political solution. You have now created Jammu and Kashmir integrated as a part of India, unquestionable. Ladakh as a separate entity, and you have reiterated 1994 resolution to say the whole of Jammu and Kashmir belongs to India. And we aspire to do that. That is a solution. But a political solution with Pakistan, if you are saying, many people talk about a political solution with Pakistan. I think, if you are meaning the period 2004 to 2007, the four-point formula of General Parvez Musharraf, that I don't think that is something which is acceptable to India. The India of today, it is not acceptable.
One last question here.
No, last question to the lady. Come on. Yeah.
One question, very important.
Why don't you take it offline with him after the meeting?
Ashish, with your permission, we can end after this question. We'll end with the.
That's what I'm saying. And then we can go to what he goes.
Afterwards?
Yeah, exactly. Okay, just let her finish and you ask them. Yeah.
Sir, you talked about the ecosystem, right? Now, linked with that. My question is, did demonetization play any role in reducing the fundings and all? Secondly, the role of Huriyat along with that?
Role of?
Huriyat conference.
Huriyat.
Okay. And sir, just yesterday it was announced that they are going to rebuild the temples, but two things which the media did not pick up was building up the schools and the cinema halls. Thank you, sir.
Right. Demonetization. I'm very happy and very proud to tell you that the first stone of the stone throwing in 2008 was thrown at my car. Okay. First stone in Baramura, it was thrown at my car. Bishnoi was very much there with me at that time. He used to keep traveling around with me in Baramura town. Right. I'm very proud of that fact that it was first thrown at me. But when we discovered, when we went into the analysis of stone throwing in 2008, let me tell you, there is nothing as professional as the stone throwing of Kashmir. In Baramula, what happened was, the stone used to be imported from somewhere. The stone thrower came from somewhere else. And they came together, man it up and threw stones on us. Now, it was such a professionally done up. Why the people from outside, if the locals throw stones, they can be recognized by the soldiers and by the policemen. Here, before, because you're not going to be firing on them. Just remember one thing, when you accost a stone thrower, you don't pick up a rifle and start firing at him. Right? So, what happened, they mentally throw stones. The police will fire a few rounds in the air and this, that, the army will land up there and hold a fort out there suddenly. The whole thing will finish in about an hour's time. They'll make their statement to the media and things like that. That's what happens. What we discovered was that all the Rediwalas of Baramula, who used to put vegetables and all these things every day, most of these Rediwalas, first of all, are all on drugs. All of them needed their everyday dose of smack. And they were promised either a dose of smack or they were promised 500 rupees. Don't put your ready today, take 500 rupees for throw stones. So there was a amount of cash going around all over. This is the cash which comes as a part of the ecosystem. There are accounts all over Delhi in different banks, as ATM cards available with people in Kashmir who are pulling out money from there. Right? No one used to look at things like the amount of cash coming from the Pakistan High Commission into the pockets of the Huriyat, where they used to go for the Pakistan, for example, the National Day on 23rd of March, when everyone had finished the biryani, they used to come back with bags of money in their pockets. We used to report this and nobody used to do anything about it. So definitely when demonetization took place, suddenly there was a dearth of money. But I won't say that alone stopped it. No, it didn't. The ecosystem itself has, the targeting of the ecosystem has made a major difference. Number two, the arrest of a number of stone throwers, their leaders, etc., their detention, and taking them away from Kashmir. Although the earlier year, what happened, you arrest a stone thrower and you put him into central jail. Central jail, he lives alongside a terrorist. In one night, he becomes a terrorist. My threat to the people in Baramula and places like that was that if we arrest, in future we arrest a stone thrower, we'll send him to Jammu. So that he neither gets the biryani, he neither gets the mobile, he neither gets the SIM card, nothing. The only thing which he'll get there is a good beating from the Dogras, from the Dogra policeman. And that used to scare the hell out of them, because to go and meet your son meant you have to spend 5,000 rupees to go buy a sumo to the Navrata or Jammu and to meet your son. Here you pay 500 rupees and go to the central jail in Srinagar. So there were ways found to do this. This whole ecosystem had to be taken apart. So demonetization played a temporary role in it, definitely, but not everything. The role of the Huriyat has been, you see, the Huriyat, why it was promoted, why it was tolerated by the government of India for many years, was that fond hope, that's my assessment, the fond hope of what is called the Mizoram model. Mizoram, if you study the Mizoram model, the people who were the militants all came back to become the rulers by election. They all came and became chief ministers and this and that. Perfect model of insurgency, counter-insurgency and how you restore order. We were always in the hope that we will do a Mizoram on the Huriyat. But the Huriyat turned completely wrong. And they didn't come on board at all. I think that the BJP government realized this very early. And this time, they have been detained and kept apart, kept away. No longer are they in a position to be able to influence the ecosystem. Did they have any other question?
Cinema halls in the schools.
Remember, the best schools of Kashmir are run by one organization. Can you show me which is that organization? The Indian Army. 43 schools. 43 schools are run by the Indian Army. Including a boarding school, and you'll be shocked to go and see that at Pahalgam. It's a boarding school there which we run. There's some outstanding results and people jump over each other to take admission in these schools. That is the model we need to adopt for all these schools. Yes, education has to come in a very, very big way along with tourism. sports. Are you seeing the number of women from Kashmir who are coming out and becoming champions around the world in kind of sports which I have never heard of? All unconventional sports, and you will find only Kashmiri girls and Kashmiri women doing outstanding. These are the kind of things which will make a huge difference to encourage them. I can tell you the last parting thing. I started a thing called the Kashmir Premier League cricket tournament. Taking IPL as an example, 390 matches were played in 2011. I spent 1.45 crore rupees of government funds, right? Very well spent money. I asked Bishan Singh Bedi, who was our advisor on cricket, how much would the BCCI have spent if they had played 390 matches? He said 1,000 crores. Right? 1.45 crores, and I kept 400,000 people away from the roads. Everyone was talking cricket, discussing cricket. There was cricket on Doordarshan every day. Sports is a huge thing in Kashmir, and we need to encourage it. That is what will make a major difference.
Last one. Yeah, come on, last one.
One last one.
Yeah.
Quick question. See, the Saksam Valley you have shown already.
Saksam, yeah.
Yeah, but the other problem is the CPC, the infrastructure that has gone through, which has gone through Gilgit-Baltistan, and that is reaching Wadar. So what is our strategy for that? The basic issue is, unless see any solution, any takeover, anything, and that China infiltration, literally in that,
two positions
must be answered.
Two important things.
We need to deal with
this. While handing over the Saksam Valley, Pakistan, in its agreement with China, had signed on one thing, which said that subject to future resolutions of Jammu and Kashmir, Saksam will be returned to the party which gets Jammu and Kashmir. That's number one. I mean, to be fair to Pakistan, this is the provision that they had put down. But yes, you're absolutely right. The entire China-Pakistan economic corridor has moved through Saksam Valley into Gilgit-Baltistan, into Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, and reached Gwadar where it is at the moment. That is why when you talk about POK and return of POK to India, I look at only the sliver of POK here. Gilgit-Baltistan, although is huge territory, bigger than what Kashmir is only got a 600,000 population. That's about all. It will bring you into loggerheads with China. There is no doubt about it. It will link. And this will be have to be thought through. At the moment, what we are doing is only making noises. Good noises we are making about it. But we will have to plan this out in the future as to how this has to be worked out. I don't foresee this happening in 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 years. It's a long-term project. And depending much on our relationship with China, future relationship with China. It is not necessary that our relationship with China will always remain contentious.
But we have tackled them in Doklam. So it's very interesting because I keep going to Bhutan from 2008. So there is a model. There is a model where we can take them on.
Doklam is a very different thing. Don't confuse it. Don't confuse Doklam with this at all. Let me tell you first of all, anyone who knows Doklam will tell you that Doklam was a sham on the part of the Chinese.
Exactly.
They could never have made a... You think they could conduct operations through the Chumbi Valley and come down into the Siliguri corridor? On both sides, the Indian Army was located.
Absolutely.
Bhutan and Sikkim.
Absolutely.
Right? So it was a great show of bravado, and that bravado is continuing in the sense that they've got a huge regimental-sized camp that they've put up right in front of you.
Right.
Countries who want to fight wars don't put up their camps right in front to show you. They put them behind hills from where they bring troops to fight you. You see, none of our camps are sitting in front like that. Right? So, Doklam is a very, very different issue to this completely. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. So, we're supposed to end at 6 and it's 7 and you have a full house. Dhawal said, we were first defensive, now we are offensively defensive. So, congratulations, and so we are proud of the Indian Army and we sleep peacefully thanks to you. Manish, over to you for a vote of thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Before I propose a word of thanks, I would hand over this instant memory to General Thank you. There's a small announcement from the organizers. While on the way out, there's a feedback form. So please fill up the feedback form. It will help the organizers to have better events. Second thing is, before I propose a word of thanks, just want to acknowledge the presence of Admiral A.C. Rao here. A pleasure and a matter of pride moment to present a word of thanks to a person like the today, General Tausen. But before that, sir, your speech today has made me nostalgic and taken me in the 80s when I went to as a child for a holiday with my grandparents. And after that, my mom, my wife and children have never been to Kashmir. But surely with your speech today, definitely I'm sure that I'll be taking them for a holiday to Kashmir.
You must go for the Amarnath Yatra.
Absolutely, absolutely. And just how we sorted out, the army sorted out the problems in Punjab, we'll be able to sort out the problems in Kashmir also. Sir, you have inspired us, your talk has inspired us today, and we all have realized that we are Indians first. Thank you very much. First, to keep our borders safe and we relax in our homes in Bombay. And on behalf of all the three organizations today, I request all of you all to propose a very well.
Please join us for tea and coffee in the next room, please.